Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews and our COVID-19 back to school special, the school year getting underway with distance learning once again. How can students, parents, and educators make the best of what's clearly not the way we'd want learning to happen? We'll get into distance learning in just a few moments, and we'll include as many of your questions as we can throughout the program. But first, when will it be safe to return to the classroom? How will we know when students and educators can feel comfortable knowing they won't get COVID-19 in the classroom and that they won't bring it home to the people they live with? And what about those people who say we're overreacting, who say that students and teachers should be in the classroom now? Joining us to help us get through all of this is Dr. Yvonne Maldonado, professor and chief of pediatric infectious diseases at Stanford University School of Medicine and the Lucile Packard Children's Hospital. Dr. Maldonado, thanks for joining us. Let me start with the question I just asked. Are we overreacting? Is it true that children have lower rates of infection and that when they do get COVID-19, they typically experience only mild symptoms or no symptoms at all? Should we have kids in school now?
Well, those are two separate questions. So first of all, let me address the issue around children and disease. And it does appear from data from around the world and from the United States that children are less likely to get sick when they're infected. And it appears that they are less likely to be sick at all. So if you look at the data nationally, less than 10% of cases of reported COVID in the US are in children. Now, it's possible that they may be asymptomatic, and therefore that's why we're not picking them up, but we don't really have strong evidence that that's the case. It does appear as well that children are very unlikely to be sick enough to be hospitalized. And there have been extremely low numbers of deaths around the United States in children with COVID disease. So I do think in general, children, for some reason that we don't really understand, aren't getting as sick. Not to say that some haven't, but they're very probably less likely to be sick than older children and even and especially adults. Now, the question about whether or not they're going to transmit is also a little more complicated. We don't know very well because we shut down here in the U.S. before we really were into the pandemic during school time. So we are depending on data from other countries. And in those situations, what it appears to be is that young children under five appear not to transmit disease as often as older children and adults. And in fact, it looks like in some studies, children between 10 and 19 years of age are more likely to infect other people in their households than young children. Mm. And in general, rates of transmission outside of households is very low for all ages. So that's actually reassuring that although schools can in some ways can represent a household type setting because of the time of exposure and the potential for close contact.
You mentioned other parts of the world and what we've learned. We know that in Israel, for example, they seem to have bent the curve. They felt that they were on the right side of the pandemic. They went back into school. This was in May, I believe. And what did we learn from their experience?
Right. Well, Israel was had similar experiences to what we saw here in California over the last few months. And what happened there is they really locked down and they were very careful and they reduced their number of infections to very small numbers. And then I think they got overconfident. They said, let's just go ahead and open up schools and businesses. And while they did have regulations for distancing and masks, they weren't well enforced. And people felt that the disease was gone. And what then happened is they had a huge epidemic. School kids got infected. Again, there weren't very many serious infections, but they definitely brought it home, infected families. And then in addition, restaurants and businesses opened. And again, masking was not enforced. And there was also a parallel rise of infections in the community at large. So I think we can learn from that. And certainly we've seen that happen in California where we thought we were doing well. We started to go to stage two. We opened up a lot of businesses, which was great, but we also forgot that we need to continue to distance and wear masks. And with that, we started to see a surge of our first wave. So we haven't actually left our first wave here in California. But if we remember that behavior is driving this epidemic and that we can wear masks and distance and still go outside and go to restaurants and do other activities, then I think we should be able to get the numbers back down. But we're not going to get to zero anytime soon until the virus is gone everywhere, because the virus will travel from one state to another, from one country to another.
Yeah. We'd like to get to as many viewer questions as possible. So let's begin with this one from Victoria. Victoria says, is it a bad idea to reopen schools, whether a partial or full reopening? Would bringing children back to school increase the risk of exposure to the coronavirus for everyone on the campuses?
Well, that's a great question. And I think a lot of that depends on what's going on locally. And we're advising people here in the school districts in the San Francisco Bay Area. And it really depends on what resources the schools have, what resources the districts have, what resources the teachers have, what the degree of transmission is in the community where you live and the county that you live in, and especially what the county regulations are. Mm. So, for example, if you have a school that feels like they can distance their teachers, the teachers can be masked, you can put the kids in pods, you can do deep cleaning at least once a day and regular cleaning at least a couple times a day, and you can limit the amount of contact, hopefully to no contact, among children and teachers, then it could be safe to bring people back. If any of that is really not available in a reasonable way, then I would suggest maybe a staggered approach where perhaps the teachers would come back to school first and then maybe slowly reintroduce children. And in general, it would seem that the best way to bring children back might be to start with the little kids, because they may be less likely to get infected and potentially to bring disease back and forth from school. Well, and what we're understanding is that it's more likely that children are going to bring infection to the school rather than from the school. So the kids are getting infected from family members, and they might bring it into the school.
Well, let me ask a question from Morgan, which sort of follows on what you're talking about in terms of having social distancing on a campus. How can we expect children to socially distance in a social setting, which is by definition what sort of a classroom is? What precautions, and then should specifically young preschool age children take?
Well, that's where the staggered approach or the hybrid models, as they call them, would be helpful. So it would be very difficult to do that if you have a large school with lots of children and the rooms are small and cramped, especially if there's no ventilation or poor ventilation. I would suggest that what people are thinking about is bringing back some of the children so that some children come back a couple days a week and then the others are virtual those days, and then alternating so that the children still get the social experience, but they're not close together. It's really helpful if they can stay at least 6 feet apart. And in some situations, some organizations are recommending that if you have to get to be 3 feet apart, that is at desks, that at least there be masking and maybe physical barriers for those kids. So, for example, plexiglass barriers.
We know that in adults, if you have a pre-existing condition like diabetes or asthma, that you may have a more severe outcome if you get COVID-19. And we have a question from Yolanda about her daughter. She has a 12-year-old daughter who has mild to moderate asthma. Is it safe for her to return to school? Is a face shield as effective as a mask to protect from COVID-19? And does that shield provide better oxygen flow than the possible CO2 buildup from wearing that mask?
Okay, those are a lot of questions. So yeah. I think that generally people with underlying conditions should be more careful, obviously. But we, again, don't have any evidence that in children those conditions will lead them to be more likely to be sick if they're, and certainly not more likely to get infected. However, I would take more precautions, and I would consult with the teachers to see what the situation is at the school. Face shields could be helpful, and I think that they're a great idea. We use them in the hospital because it keeps our masks clean, so that we can reuse the masks and our masks don't get infected with droplets from others. Whether or not they work in the school setting has not been tested, but I would imagine that if they keep droplets off of your face, they could be helpful. And I don't know the answer to the question about oxygen. I imagine that, we use them all the time, and I think we're okay. So I'm sure that you're getting lots of oxygen flow behind the face shield. It's not a bubble.
Here's a question from Joy, and Joy says she is a preschool teacher. And Joy says, does the playground equipment need to be sanitized each time a new group of children goes outside to play on that? And I would imagine the question also would apply to older kids than just preschool.
Yeah, I do think that there should be a deep clean every day, preferably in the evening, so it's ready to go in the morning. And I do think that the children should make sure that they are cleaning, hand sanitizing, and that they're cleaned before they go out to use equipment. And it should probably be cleaned, not deep cleaned, but it should be wiped down in between groups of children.
Dr. Maldonado, thank you so much for the work that you do and for joining us today.
Thank you so much, and everybody stay safe.
Thank you. All right, coming up next, how can we best prepare our children and ourselves for distance learning? Someone who has some concrete steps you can take when we come back. And welcome back to our COVID-19 back to school special. Are you prepared for another semester of distance learning? If the thought makes you tense, you are not alone. A national survey by the nonprofit Learning Heroes indicates that 65% of parents are anxious or worried. Here's some other key takeaways from that survey taken during the spring semester of distance learning. Learning Heroes found that 33% of students had regular access to teachers. Only 15% of parents received personal guidance about how to support their child. And only 13% of students had one-on-one time or tutoring with their teachers. We are joined now by the founder and CEO of Learning Heroes, Bib Hubbard. Hi, Bib, and thanks very much for joining us.
Happy to be here. Thank you so much.
What did those findings say to you?
So it said to us that we also found that parents were deeply engaged in their children's learning last spring, so spending an average of 2.5 hours every day with their children's learning. So to see those numbers where they just weren't getting the materials, the time, the engagement with teachers was a bit shocking. Although parents gave districts, schools, and teachers the benefit of the doubt because we were all thrown in this together. So as we look towards back to school, parents definitely have an expectation that schools have had time to get their acts together, that they're supporting teachers in terms of being ready to go back to school and to ready for remote learning or hybrid learning. And so I think the expectations are much higher for parents as we head back to school.
You came to my attention because I saw an article in the New York Times that said how we can proactively prepare for distance learning. And before we get to some of our viewer questions about that, were there a couple of takeaways from that article that you can share that parents can use right now?
Yeah, it's really important to partner up with your child's teacher. You're the expert on your child, and especially this year, teachers will not have an opportunity to get to know your child in person. So offering your observations, what does your child love to do? What do they not love to do? Where do they struggle? Where do they thrive? Really giving teachers a window into who your child is and how they learn is going to be more important than ever. So there are lots of ways that you as a parent can support your children's learning at home without having to be a co-teacher or a teacher, but really working in lockstep with your child's teacher and creating a plan for how you're going to have those ongoing communications so that it's manageable for you as a parent as well as the teacher.
Here's a question from one of the our viewers. It's a parent of a five-year-old. This is Kat.
So I have a five-year-old who usually is very bubbly and the first to make contact with new friends. She's going into kindergarten in September and has had her first Zoom with her new classmates. And the whole experience, I think she found daunting and she was very shy. So I'm just concerned about the social development of not actually being in the classroom with all the classmates.
So what are your thoughts for Kat?
Yeah, so Kat, I think you're right spot on to be concerned about the social interactions. That is a concern for all parents, especially parents of little ones such as your daughter. And I think making her feel comfortable with Zoom and maybe even reaching out to some of her classmates and having some separate one-on-one Zooms with some of her classmates so she gets to know her peers more individually, and can build some bonds and do some activities together on Zoom. And then also making sure that you are, again, talking with your child's teacher. What makes her tick? What's going to bring her out of her shell? What makes her feel daunted? Mm. All of that is gold for a teacher so that they can make sure that they're pulling her in at the right times and calibrating their instruction for her. So just being an active participant with the teacher and a viewer an observer will go a long way in making sure that she gets the developmental support she needs.
Sharon has a question that I think is specific to her school district, but I think we can pull from it to benefit everyone. She says, what's being done for young children just learning to read but not well enough to use computers? Will learning materials be available at school that parents can pick up for those age groups? What can be done for children who fit into that category?
Yeah, and based on the spring, only about a quarter of the parents reported that they had access to printed materials at the school. So it is a really valid, important question, making sure that she is asking her school explicitly for those printed materials to help her child. I think that's a great point. And you know, if she does have access to online, she can go to different sites like Scholastic, bealearninghero.org. We have we curate a lot of other organizations' content, so she can come to our site and get the benefit of other people's content. And also, we have something called the Readiness Check, which is a K-8 mini assessment. It gives parents a gut check as to whether or not their child is mastering those foundational skills, both in literacy and math. So as her child is learning how to read, encourage her to go to the readiness check and just check and see how she's developing and how she's doing.
Here's a question from Sarah. She says parents of children with special needs or IEPs, individualized education programs, have it incredibly hard during the pandemic. In-home learning means these children have few or no services. What suggestions do you have to help them?
Again, it's such a real raw issue, and given that the children's learning needs are so varied around IEPs, it's such a unique situation. So I can't quite give her specific guidance. I know understood.org is a great resource if she wants to turn to an online tool that has a vast array of different information, resources, and content for parents with children who have IEPs, 504s, and those sorts of things.
Here's a tricky one at all times, not just during the pandemic, but this comes to us from Kimberly. For high school students, how do parents encourage independence in their education, yet still check in? We don't want to be helicopter parents, but we want to be there, we want to support. How do we do that?
Actually, this was my question. So I am a parent of two high school students, actually a recent graduate of high school. So I asked my high school student today, I was like, how do I do this? So I think it's a valid question. I think it's, you know, if they are saying that they're doing well and you're talking with their teachers and the teachers are giving you positive reinforcing feedback, you let them be independent. You let them, you know, take ownership of their learning. But it's also important to do have those emotional conversations, be there to support them, understand when they need a little extra nudge or some organizational help, perhaps. So it is sort of that dance of not trying to helicopter too much, but also give them the support and let them know that you're there for them if they need you.
All right, Bibb, we're going to ask you to hang on for 1 second. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be back with at least one more viewer question for Bibb Hubbard from Learning Heroes. And we're back with Bibb Hubbard from Learning Heroes answering your questions. We have one more question from Randy, Bibb, and it's maybe the money question. How long will distance learning last?
Yeah, that is definitely the million-dollar question, and I wish I were equipped to be able to answer it. I think we just don't know, and I think we have to kind of buckle up and settle in and just do the best we can in the remote setting, and ideally we'll move to hybrid as soon as possible, but safety first.
Right. Well, Bib Hubbard, we do appreciate what you're doing to help school districts and schools get through this situation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate being here.
Of course. And we know that you at home have more questions, and we want to give you a couple of websites that you might check out for help. One is bealearninghero.org. That's Bib Hubbard's nonprofit group. And of course, the state of California's page dedicated to education is at COVID-19.ca.gov, and it's /education. And of course, your local school district will also have some resources for you as well. I hope this has been helpful as we enter the new school year. Thanks for your questions, and thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.